Yeah, hello students. Today I'm going to start with the next topic, which is water resources in geography. Now, water is a very important natural resource. It is also said to be a renewable resource. Now, for a country like India, it's an agricultural country. It has an agrarian economy. So, which means that almost 70% of the people are actually dependent on agriculture for their livelihood, directly or indirectly. So it is a very important activity. So the most important input, other than what you call improved seeds, good quality seeds, fertilizers, manure, the most important input is water. So water needs to be adequately sufficient for proper growth of crops. So it is very important. Now, agriculture is such an activity which is carried throughout the year. But India receives rainfall mainly during the rainy season, which is from June to September. So what about the other months of the year? They remain dry except for the Coromandel coast, which is the east coast. Those receive rainfall from during the winter, during the winter season, from the tropical depressions, all that is there. But then, whereas for the other months of the year, that which is, like I said, the drier period, we require water for irrigation for the agricultural activity, which I'll be explaining in detail in the next frame. Now, first, like I said, water is an important component. So, the natural source is actually rainfall. So, rainfall is the primary source from where we get water. Now, this primary source fills the other secondary sources, like there is rivers, lakes, streams, ponds, groundwater. So, if the primary source, which is rainfall, if it is not adequate, then the secondary sources will remain dry. So when they remain dry, what happens is it affects the overall water supply in the country. And for the drier months, we require to supply water artificially, which is done through irrigation. So that irrigation, different methods of irrigation also I will be taking later. Now here, the next part is sources of water. Now what are the different sources? Like I said, rainfall is a primary source. Other than that, we have surface water and there is groundwater. Surface water, which you find on the surface of the land, like there is rivers, there are rivers, there are lakes, ponds, streams. It is said that almost 60% of the rivers water, the surface water, comes from the rivers, which are like basically the Indus, the Ganga, the Brahmaputra. Almost 60% of the water, so surface water, comes from there. Other than that, there are lakes, streams, and also, like I said, ponds, from where you can draw water. Next is groundwater. Groundwater means under the ground, the water actually seeps through the what you call cracks, the crevices, the openings, and it settles down at the bottom till where it cannot move further down. So there it creates a pool, it's a water table that it creates, and there it settles down there. And when you dig the soil, that's where you find water. So water is drawn from under the ground. So that is the underground water that is there. Next, I'm going to explain why this water is very important to conserve. Now, next we come to why it is important to conserve water. Like I said, water is very important for agriculture and many other, it has varied uses. Like it's used in domestic, for consumption, for domestic needs, the industrial uses there. So, but now it has been observed that there is an acute shortage of water. Now, why is the shortage being experienced? Now, so because of that, you have to conserve water. So, there is an acute shortage of water all around the world. And why is this shortage happening? There are certain reasons behind this. Like I said, when the population increases, the demand for water also will increase. Now, if rainfall is not adequate, that will put extra pressure on the existing water resources that are available in the country. So, now large and growing population increases the demand for water. Now, when population increases again, what happens? The demand for food also will increase. Now, when demand for food increases, there is an extra pressure that will be exerted on agriculture. So, agriculture production also has to increase to meet the demands of the growing population. So what they will do is, whatever available water resources are there, they will use that. But because of extra demand for food, they will have to increase the production also, which means that more water will be required, more good quality seeds they will require, that requires a lot of water also. Fertilizers, chemical fertilizers are used to increase production, for that also water is required. So then what they do is, they withdraw water from the that is underground water that they start to withdraw. So there is a rapid depletion of underground water as well. So that is the second cause. So increasing population also creates increased demand for food, which exerts pressure on agriculture. So I have written point by point here. Extra pressure on agriculture puts pressure on the existing water resources, which leads to fall in the groundwater level. So a lot of wells are dug, tube wells are dug. So which, as a result of which, a lot of water is withdrawn. So excessive over exploitation of underground water is done there. So that also causes a shortage of water. Now the next is, because of so many industries also require water for their processing. So these industries, what they do is they proper, you know, treatment of water waste, water is not done. So all the waste water is discharged into the rivers. So with that, the water bodies also gets polluted. So industries, then domestic, whatever sewage is there, whatever domestic waste is there, generally you see like wherever water bodies are, people just dump there. So the water bodies there get polluted. Then again, lot of excessive use of chemical fertilizers, you know, all these pesticides, finally the water goes underneath. And then it gets mixed with the water table that is there. So with that also the water gets polluted. So all these are the reasons due to which causes a what you call water scarcity. Water pollution takes place. You don't have enough water to consume. Like it is said that out of the total water body that is there, 71% of the earth's surface is covered with water. Now out of the 71%, it is said that 97% constitutes what you call oceanic water, which is actually salty. So it is not consumable. So only the remaining, like, you know, 3% almost is like what is potable water, you can say, fresh water. Now out of these, they say that around 2.5% is actually, you know, trapped in the solar, you know, in the polar, what you call caps, the glaciers there. So what you get is almost like around 1.5%, which is actually the fresh water, that is the river water, lakes, underground water, which is very less in number. Now that also, if that gets polluted, then it will cause a major, like, you know, crisis. The water crisis that most of the countries are facing nowadays. So that is why it is very important to conserve water. This question is important because generally it has been asked, most papers they ask this question, the need to conserve water. Now the next part, which is irrigation, that is artificially supplying water to the fields. Now what are the different methods and why it is required? So that I will be doing in the next frame. Yeah, next we come to the next part, which is irrigation. Like I said at the start, we don't receive water throughout the year. The natural source is rainfall, which we get only for 4 months, like basically from June to September. There are some areas which receive winter rainfall, but not the whole of India. So, but agriculture is an activity which is carried out not only in those 4 months, but throughout 12 months. There are places which, you know, have agriculture or conduct this activity during the winter months also. So there is no water during that time. So water has to be supplied to the crops artificially. So when water is supplied to the crops artificially, it is called as irrigation. So rainfall is a natural way, it's a natural source, but the artificial sources through wells, canals, tanks, tube wells, all that we'll be learning in detail next. Now, so this is called as irrigation. Next is, why is irrigation important? Like I said at the start, like we receive rainfall only for 4 months, so that is when we get rainwater. But there are days when it doesn't rain all the year, you know, every day of these 4 months it doesn't rain. So there are days when there are dry spells as well. So then again you require water. So then because of that, irrigation is required. So seasonal rainfall is one major reason. Rainfall is confined only for 4 months, that is from June to September. The rest of the year is dry. So for the rest of the year also you require water, because agriculture is carried out. So you require water, and that you require it through irrigation. Uneven distribution of rainfall. This means that there are certain places in India that receive good amount of rainfall. Like you have Mausimram, then there is Cherrapunji, which is in Meghalaya. So there they receive, you know, a lot of rainfall, like heavy rainfall. So there again, and there are places like Rajasthan, like the western part of Rajasthan, that receives very little rainfall, 25 centimeters. So if you're doing agriculture, even in the eastern part, they require what? Irrigation. There, the irrigation takes place through canal irrigation there, mostly. So then again, this is another one reason. Third is uncertain rainfall. Like I said, sometimes even it is said that rainfall, India receives rainfall in the first week of June. Basically for 1st June, 2nd June, it strikes India, mostly the southern part of India, which is Kerala. But there are times when there are late arrivals. So when there is late arrival, that also affects crop, production. Like, you know, adversely affects crop. So then that uncertain rainfall also is a major hindrance. So at that point of time, you require water to supply to the fields. So it helps. So irrigation helps again here. Now different crops require different water requirements. So which means that there are crops like rice, but then there is jute, there is sugarcane, there is even cotton, which require a good amount of water. I don't know whether you all have seen the paddy fields, like the rice fields. It is submerged, you know, in water during the growing time. So then it requires a lot of water, even jute. So they require good amount of water. At the same time, there are crops like wheat, pulses, oil seeds, which require less water. But for that, you require irrigation. So that is again important. Nature of soil. Now we have different types of soil. In soil we had learned, like different types of soil are found in different places depending upon the temperature, the climate, the parent rock. So nature of soil also is it is important, because here again sandy soil, like at the start I had explained in soil, that sandy soil is very porous, so the water does not retain in the soil, so it seeps under the ground. So then the soil becomes like, you know, there is less moisture in the soil, so you have to keep irrigating the soil. So for that reason you require irrigation. There is soil like clay soil, which is black soil, it does not require much of irrigation. That will result into water logging. But if the soil is sandy soil, you require water for, you know, to give moisture to the soil. So these are some of the reasons why you require irrigation. Need, sometimes the question would be asked, importance of irrigation or need for irrigation. So this part is also very important. Now, in the next frame, I'm going to explain the different types of irrigation methods that are used in different parts of the country. Yeah, now, the different methods of irrigation, like in the previous frame, I had explained why irrigation is required, because of seasonal rainfall, because of uneven distribution of rainfall. So now, for that reason, we require irrigation to irrigate the crops, to supply water to the crops. So there are different methods of irrigation. Now you can't apply the same methods everywhere, because different areas have a different type of soil. The rainfall, the amount of rainfall that region receives also varies. And there are many other conditions that are there, because of which you can't apply the same irrigation method everywhere. Now what type of irrigation are you going to apply in these areas? Now in methods of irrigation, the first one I'm going to explain is well irrigation. Now well irrigation comes under underground source, water source, because generally you dig the soil and you actually withdraw the water from underneath the ground, and that is called as well irrigation. Mostly most of the wells are 5 to 6 or 7 meters deep, but there are certain wells that are dug up to 15 meters deep. So if you want to go beyond that, like if you don't find water, then there is another method of irrigation which is called as tubewell irrigation, where it goes much much deeper, where you get the water table that goes sometimes even 250 below the ground. So for that you have to go for tubewell irrigation. So there is a machine, drilling machine, you drill the machine, it's a pipe that is there, that is installed, and then that water is actually withdrawn. Sometimes manually also you withdraw the water, that becomes little tedious. Then there are pumps that are used, so electricity is also required under tubewell. So this is well irrigation, where the water level is at a height, the groundwater is at a height. So there you can use well irrigation. Now what are the conditions? Like you can't do dig soil everywhere, so there are certain conditions. What are the conditions required? The soil needs to be soft, so preferably alluvial soil. So most of the wells you would find in the northern plains, because northern plain has alluvial soil, soft soil. So then soft soil is there. So when the soil is soft, it helps in digging. Easy digging is enables easy digging. Then also because of the soft soil, that area also receives good amount of rainfall. So the water also is absorbed into the ground. So for that reason, soft soil is required for well irrigation, for digging. Also the water table should be high, so you are able to withdraw the water. Adequate rainfall also should be there in these areas. So these are the conditions that is required for well irrigation. Now there are certain advantages and disadvantages in every type of what you call irrigation method. The advantages here under well irrigation is that it is simple and easy to construct and maintain. Okay, and the farmers also can actually construct it near their fields, so that it becomes easy for them to withdraw the water and supply it to the fields. So you can construct it anywhere. But provided the, like I said, the soil should be soft and water table should be high. There has to be water under the ground. So rainfall should also be there. Third is what, it can be set up at any convenient place, like I said, and it's cheaper also. So it is very affordable for the farmers also to construct wells. Now disadvantages are, the wells are shallow. Or like I said, it is like 5 meters or sometimes 7 meters deep. So then it is also has a larger area, like, you know, open area. So it is, you know, subject to evaporation. So during the dry area, sometimes these wells, most of the wells in the northern, you know, plains, like, you know, because of the Lu and like May and June, it's very hot. So, you know, some of these wells dry up also, which is actually when it is required the most to water the fields. So that is a disadvantage. They also irrigate, you know, limited areas, like because like the wells are shallow, the water also is like hardly 1 to 2 hectares of land that you can irrigate. So a lot of water also you are not able to withdraw. And also wells sometimes have brackish water, because it's like, brackish means salty water, which is not fit for cultivation and it is not fit for consumption also. So some of these wells also have salty water in them. So these are some of the disadvantages. Also the government also is actually financially helping these farmers to, you know, make a lot of wells. But because of that, more number of wells have been set up and more water is being withdrawn. So that also results into depletion of groundwater. So that again is a disadvantage. So these are the advantages, disadvantages under wells and also conditions that are required to construct wells. Next, I will go to tube well, which is also similar to well irrigation. Yeah, the next irrigation method is tube well irrigation. This is quite similar to well irrigation. The only difference is this goes much more deeper as compared to well irrigation, because here the water generally you don't find at a high, the water is not at a high level, so it is much more deeper, so you have to drill it further down. So you require machines, like drilling machines, to actually go to the saturation water table there. So then it is more expensive because you require machines and you know all those things, pumps are required, PVC pipes are required. So it is more expensive compared to well irrigation. But yes, you are able to draw more water compared to well irrigation. Here again, there are certain conditions, advantages and disadvantages that comes under tube well irrigation. The conditions are quite similar. The first three points are quite similar, exactly the same. Like here also you require soft soil, because tube well, so it requires digging, the soil has to be soft. Second one is the ground table should be here, should be there, should be high level of water should be there. Second, third is adequate rainfall should be there, so that the water gets replenished, the ground level gets recharged. Also cheap electricity is required, because obviously the water has to be drawn from under the ground and from deep depths. Next is advantages. Advantages, it's useful during actually drought season when wells dry up. During drought, that is during the dry season when the wells dry up, because wells are shallow and they have a bigger, you know, the circumference that is there, it's more. So because of that, the evaporation is faster. So here the tube wells have a smaller area, so then that, and they go much deeper, so that evaporation thing doesn't happen much there. So the water is more there. Irrigate larger areas, like I said, 400 hectares approximately, whereas in the previous well it was only 1 to 2 hectares. So little water is withdrawn as compared to tube well. Occupy less area. Like I said, wells are like, you know, much more, you know, broader. The circumference is much more compared to tube wells. So that much area you can use for cultivation. So that much area you're saving for cultivation. So these come under advantages. Disadvantages, yes, because you're using machines and, you know, pipes, so then it is much more expensive compared to well irrigation. Also electricity is required, even that adds to the extra expense of the farmer. Since these withdraw larger quantity of water, there is large scale depletion of groundwater, because like I said, more water can be withdrawn. So sometimes, you know, more water, because of that, the depletion of the groundwater gets it happens. So that if that replenish, it doesn't get recharged, the groundwater does not get recharged, you know, along the same time, what will happen? There will be depletion, there will be lesser water. And also because of that, when it is actually needed, that time water won't be there, mainly during the dry season because of excessive withdrawal. So these are the advantages, disadvantages and conditions that come under tube well. Next, I'll go to tank irrigation. Next irrigation is tank irrigation. Now tank irrigation comes under surface source. Wells and tube wells came under underground water source. Now tank irrigation, because it's found on the surface. Now your tank, the meaning tank, you have heard about water tanks, like water tanks which sometimes in some homes water tanks are there to collect the water, building tanks are there. So basically it's a place where you store water. So here in tank irrigation, mostly tank irrigation you will find it's more prevalent in South India, Deccan Plateau, because there the terrain is very uneven, like very rocky and uneven. The only reason being, if it had soft soil, like in well irrigation and tube well irrigation, the water would actually percolate down and it will go down deep under, so that storage thing doesn't happen, then it will be like well irrigation. So under tank irrigation, the place that is in Deccan Plateau, there is hard rocks, uneven terrain, impervious, like non-porous rocks. So there, digging of wells after a certain depth becomes very difficult because it's hard rocks are there, and it becomes very difficult and very difficult to dig also and expensive also. So there, tank irrigation is very helpful. So it's like a depression where it's a natural depression. So then water gets stored there, and that water is used for irrigation. Next, what people do is they make wells around the tanks, so that the water is like, you know, it stays there, it does not overflow. And there are so many temple wells, tanks, wells are there. So there are steps there. So different types of tanks are there. So this is used for irrigation. So what are the conditions? Like I said, for every irrigation, there are conditions. Like here, the ground underneath should be rocky or impervious. It should be uneven, so that it's non-porous. So the water does not seep through, it does not percolate down. So it gets settled there. So that condition is required. Secondly, natural depression, so hollow should be there to collect the rainwater. Now here, tank irrigation is more popular here in down south. That is, sometimes a question is asked, why is tank irrigation more popular in the Deccan Plateau? Because of the same reason, because here the soil is not soft, there are hard rocks. So obviously you can't build, construct wells and canals. So it becomes more expensive. And also natural depressions are found here. There are no perennial rivers like how you find in well irrigation and, you know, tube well. Because here, this region, Deccan Plateau, receives like, you know, seasonal rainfall. So during the rainy season, there is heavy rainfall. During the drier season, there is hardly any rainfall. There is no perennial rivers like North India gets water from the snow during the summer season, it melts. So that is how the perennial rivers are there. Here no such rivers are there, seasonal streams are there. So advantages under tube well irrigation, canals, wells cannot be built here because, like I said, the soil is not soft here. So because of that, tank irrigation is constructed. Also because whenever it rains, the hollows or depressions collect the rainwater that is used to do tank irrigation. It is also cheaper because already these hollows are already there, so they can they can practice tank irrigation. Helps to raise the ground water level because now you are not dependent on the underground water, because tanks are there, you are collecting the water. So there the ground water levels are actually not decreasing because you are not using. There are certain areas where there are wells, but because of that you are not using that water, you are actually now dependent on the tank irrigation. So that ground water level is actually intact. It raises the level. Streams are seasonal because, like I said, seasonal rainfall. So during the rainy season, it overflows. Whereas during the dry season, actually there is no water. When the rain ceases, it stops. So then tank becomes more, useful. And also some streams are such that they connect. One tanks, they connect with the other tanks. So that once if the tanks overflow, the other tank also gets water. So there are systems in place wherein they connect, two tanks or different tanks. So these were like the conditions and also advantages. Next I will explain disadvantages that comes under tank irrigation. Yeah, the next one is disadvantages that come under tank irrigation. Now tank irrigation, they occupy a larger area. So obviously that much area that can be used for cultivation, that also comes under disadvantage. And also the surface area of these tanks also very large. So because of that, there is loss of water also that takes place due to tank irrigation. So when during the dry season also, if you see, there is during the dry season, obviously those areas don't receive rainfall. So then they dry up. So these are non-perennial tanks. So then you can't irrigate the fields. That also comes under as disadvantage. Silting of tanks takes place whenever it rains. So obviously the water from the surrounding areas also come and collect into these tanks. So then they bring a lot of sediments. So then silting takes place. Those are the sediments that get accumulated at the bottom of the tanks. So when that happens, you know, the level of water also then becomes reduced because that much area is occupied by those silts or sediments. So every year you have to clean the tank and you have to remove, or there are ways wherein you can actually remove all those sediments that are there. So the cleaning thing of the tanks also becomes something like, you know, a mandatory thing. So that also desilting is required. Tanks are shallow, like I said, they're not very deep, like you compare it with tube wells. So then large amount of water is lost due to evaporation. Here also large area is there, so that can be used for cultivation other than tank irrigation. Some tanks, like I said, they dry up during the, you know, dry season, summer season, winter season. So then they don't have water in them to actually irrigate the fields. And also these tanks also becomes like very difficult, like, you know, the water, you have to withdraw the water also from these tanks to irrigate the fields. Or you have to make channels, you know, from where you can actually divert the water to these fields. So these are some of the disadvantages that come under tank irrigation. Yeah, the next irrigation, canal irrigation. Now, what is the meaning of a canal? Mostly, in this type of irrigation is mostly found in northern part of India. Mostly, because first of all, to make canals, you require soft soil, because again, this involves digging. Now, canal irrigation is done in places where, you know, the rivers, like generally you have heard about dams being built. So, wherever rivers are there, so across these rivers, dams are built to actually conserve water. So, at the back of the dams, there is a man-made lake that is there, a reservoir that is there, where the water gets collected there. And then the water then flows down the dams, because there are flood gates, and it is a controlled you know, flowing of water. So there are flood gates, some very few flood gates are opened so that the water then flows down the stream. So then the remaining water gets accumulated behind the dam, and that is called as the reservoir, man-made lake or a reservoir. And then from those reservoirs, there are many channels that are made, narrow channels that are made, and then through which the water flows. That is called as a canal. So canal irrigation is that form of irrigation wherein the water is taken or drawn to the fields. So obviously, canal irrigation can be you know, dug only in places where there is soft soil. So mostly in northern part of India, the northern plain, it is very prevalent, it is very popular, like wells and tube wells, because they also require soft soil. So the requirements of water, the conditions, you can't make it everywhere, because for canal irrigation there has to be a perennial source, like from where the water comes. So the perennial source of water is required. So the northern plains, there the rivers are perennial, because during the summer season, during the rainy season, there is water throughout the year, because they get water from the Himalayas when the snow melts during the summer season, and in rainy season there is water anyways. So canal is very popular there, because they have a perennial source of water, that is the snow fed rivers are there. The second requirement is low level of flat terrain should be there, because you are making canals. So the canal, the water has to flow evenly. There can't be ups and downs, or there can't be a rocky terrain like you have in down south. Down south, in certain places only canals are there, not everywhere. So there you have mostly tank irrigation there, that I have explained previously. Now, low, flat and even terrain should be there for construction of canals. No ups and downs or humpy, you know, that terrain should not be there. Soft soil, again, like I said, for construction, for digging of canals, you need require soft soil. So these are basically the main conditions, if conditions are asked. Next comes types of canals. The different types are there. Two types are there. Perennial canals, and then there is inundation. I will explain that later. Now, perennial, as the name says, there is water throughout the year. So these canals have water throughout the year. The main reason being, these canals are taken from perennial rivers. So perennial rivers have water throughout the year. So from there, the water is channelized to these canals. So these canals also will have water throughout the year. So that's why they are called as perennial canals. Now, what are the advantages? Like, how, like, sometimes a differentiation is asked between perennial and inundation canals. So what, why are they more important? Because they are expensive, first of all, obviously, because you have to make dams or barrages in perennial canals, like from where the rivers are drawn, and then to regulate. So whenever water is, because of a heavy flow of water, the water can be regulated, because then the fields may get flooded. So then that's why that regulation can be done here. These canals are useful also during the dry season, because there is water throughout the year. So irrigation or irrigating the fields is possible, they have throughout the year water. So this comes under perennial canal. Sometimes a differentiation is asked between perennial and inundation. The next part of canals I am going to explain, which is inundation canals.
Three.
Now, under canals, the first one was perennial, which means water throughout the year in those canals. Here in this next type, second type is inundation. There are only two types, perennial and inundation. most important is most of the times they ask like, you know, questions, differentiate between perennial canals and inundation canals. Sometimes they will ask, why are inundation canals, they are trying to convert inundation canals into perennial canals, previous ones that I said. Now here the meaning of inundation canal means, inundation itself means flood, deluge, like, you know. So these canals get water only during the rainy season when the river floods. So because like I said, the other part of the year, like when during the summer season, the river flows, you know, in its normal course. So there is no excess water. But in the rainy season, because of rainfall, the river gets swollen, it gets flooded and it overflows onto the banks. So when it overflows onto the bank, then it leads to soil erosion, and then water gets you know, wasted. It causes you know, destruction of crops and property. So what they do is, places where such you know, what you call flooding takes place, there the banks of those rivers, they dig, you know, they dig those banks, and so that the extra water that is there, you know, that actually flows into the canals, and that canal takes the water to the fields. But the disadvantage is, like, it can be useful only during the rainy season, because during the dry season the river will not flood, it will flow its normal course. So then there is no water during the what you call dry season, because the canals will remain non-operational, defunct, because there is no water, it's dry, the canals are dry. So when the farmers actually need water during the dry season, they don't have water. So it's like a disadvantage. Unlike in perennial canals, when there is water throughout the year, that is during the rainy season as well as during the dry season as well. So here I have written, like, these canals are constructed by digging the banks of the rivers. They get water only when the river floods during the rainy season, that is an extra water. So like in the previously, like, differentiation, if it is asked, they are not expensive, they are cheap, and they can be easily constructed because they don't have to line the banks, I mean the inner walls of the canals. So no dams or barriers or barrages are constructed, and there is no regulation also, because when dams are there, you can regulate the flow of water. So here nothing is regulated, the water flows and it flows into the fields, right? It's like they just carry, it's just a passage. These canals are non-functional during the dry season, so this is like a disadvantage. So now they are trying to connect the inundation canals with the perennial canals, so that these canals also get water throughout the year, that is even during the dry season. Now here, after this, the next part is advantages of canals. Like canals, like I said, can be constructed only in those areas where there is soft soil. So where there are hard and rocky terrain, there tanks are most popular. Now here, because canals are constructed, like I said, the dams are built across these rivers, so they actually, you know, there is a slow movement of water. So only a restricted flow of water goes downstream. So a lot of sediments still remains, you know, in the river, like that is where the water is stored in the reservoir. So it increases the fertility of the soil as the rich sediments are brought down by the rivers. So the rivers generally, which is being where the man-made canals are there. So the canals are there which actually takes the water of these rivers, and they have a lot of sediments. So that sediment increases the fertility of the soil. Perennial canals, like I said, there are two types. So if it is a perennial canal, then those canals, you know, give water throughout the year. Initial cost is high because you are making dams and barrages. You have to even line the inner walls of the canals, otherwise there could be seepages also. So the adjoining areas also will become, like, you know, waterlogged. So that also is a disadvantage that I will come to the next point. So initial cost is high when you are making these canals, but it is cheap in the long run. So the maintenance part is not that expensive. So initial, when you are making these canals, it is expensive because you have to line, you have to make those passages. Agriculture production increases in areas receiving less rainfall, which means there is this Indira Gandhi canal. So that canal gives, you know, what you call water to the, what you call the dry areas of Rajasthan. So then there, it actually from Satluj, the Satluj river gives water to what you call the Indira Gandhi canal. So now dry areas of Rajasthan also are slowly getting converted into fertile regions. So these areas which receive less rainfall also there, because of these canals, production, that is agricultural activity, is possible there. So these are the advantages of canal irrigation. Now I will come to the disadvantage. Well, the next one is disadvantage of canals. Now, like I said previously, if the canals are not lined properly, what will happen? The water from the canal will seep through from the sides. and then there are agricultural lands just adjoining in the canals. So from there they may come up, like, you know. So those agricultural land will get swampy and waterlogged. So that is what it is written here. Canals needs to be lined, as there could be seepages resulting in waterlogging in swampy areas, that is of the adjoining areas. And so because of waterlogging, also waterlogging means the water, you know, is unable to, you know, go down, because already it is accumulated, saturation of water is there. And then because of that, sometimes because of evaporation, faster evaporation, some salts that are there in the water also then are seen, you know, on the surface of the land. That is this white salts that are there. That also makes the soil infertile. So over-irrigation also is bad for the soil and bad for the crops. Next is marshy areas. Like I said, waterlogging takes place. So marshy areas are there. They also become breeding ground for mosquitoes again. So that is again a disadvantage. Next is the water table. If the water table that is there, like when we did well irrigation, I said that the water table should be at a height. Then when you dig wells, then it is easy to, you know, withdraw the water. Only when the water table is very down, like at a lower level, then you have tube wells. So here in these areas, northern plains, so if the water table is slightly, you know, very close to the ground, so there again the alkaline salts that are there, they will come to the surface and then they will mix with the soil, and even that will make the soil infertile. So these are some of the disadvantages that comes under canal irrigation. Like every irrigation method has, some of them have advantages, I mean conditions that are required for making the irrigation methods, but at the same time there are advantages and disadvantages as well. So this, we finished with the different types of irrigation methods. Next we go to the modern methods of irrigation. Okay, now we come to the next method of irrigation, which is modern methods of irrigation. Now the only difference between modern and the previous one, which was the traditional or the conventional methods of irrigation, was that there is sometimes those methods results into water logging, and because of water logging, it could be due to excessive irrigation, which is over irrigating the fields. So the soils also remain on the fields, making the soil infertile. Here in modern methods of farming, you are using the water optimally, so there is no over irrigation, so there is no water logging. So how much the crops require, only that much of water is supplied to the fields. Now the first one, sprinkler irrigation, also it is another, spray irrigation is there and sprinkler irrigation is there, which are quite similar. Now in sprinkler irrigation, it is like, you know, it's like you're sprinkling water like onto the field. So it's like, you know, it's raining, like, you know, over the fields. So in sprinkler irrigation, what are the things, equipments that are required? Consist of pipelines, spray guns, nozzles that are there onto these fields, which are fitted into the fields, and from there the water is channelized to those nozzles there, and from there it's sprinkled onto the fields. So then many such equipments are actually erected, and that is how the fields get water. So it is like it's mentioned here, water is sprayed on the fields and the guns rotate, so they keep rotating, and from those nozzles water is sprayed. So that water quantity, everything, how much you want to spray, everything is controlled. A time is also set, like at this time it has to be sprayed, and it is sprayed for almost some few minutes, for some 10-15 minutes, and then after that it's, they stop it. So that is called. Now the next irrigation method is drip irrigation. As the name says, drip means the water flows down drop by drop, that is it trickles down. It is also called as micro irrigation because water is used, very less water is required, and this consists of network of pipelines. There are drip pipes laid across the field. So there is like, you know, a main pipe is there through which the water flows, and from the main pipe there are drip pipelines which are actually attached to the main pipe, and then that is laid across the fields, like small, you know, in black color. You would have seen in gardens, now in most gardens also they use drip irrigation. And in those drip pipeline, which is mostly black in color that you see, there are holes also. So wherever you plant trees, or wherever plantations are there, so there, you know, the hole is made so that the water falls, you know, drop by drop, and it reaches the roots of the plants. So here there is minimal loss of water, because there is hardly any evaporation that happens or leakages, because the water directly reaches the roots of the plants. So the only difference between sprinkler and drip is that in sprinkler irrigation, you know, even the areas, the cultivation area, which is, areas that you don't require, even there, the water is sprayed. Whereas here, in drip irrigation, water reaches the roots. So the, you know, the loss of what you call fertilizers due to what you call the runoff, everything gets minimized here in drip irrigation. But sprinkler irrigation also, because that much of manual labor is also saved, water reaches larger areas in sprinkler, and this is drip. Now the third one is furrow irrigation. In furrow irrigation, narrow channels, like, you know, the soil is dug, trenches are made, and water is poured in those trenches or furrows, and the furrows or the trenches should be of equal dimension. So between the crops that are there, they're at little at a height, and then furrows are made where water is poured, and then this water that is poured, it actually seeps, you know, from the sides and enters the soil. So it moistens the soil and it helps the crops also. So then water, but then yes, enough water also should be there in these areas where this furrow irrigation is practiced. So it is trenches are dug between rows of crops. Like I said, the trenches should be of equal dimensions. The water then seeps through these, you know, from the soil sideways as well as vertically down also, and moistens the soil and gives water to the crops. And here again, these are the three different methods of what you call modern methods, which is sprinkler, drip and furrow, which is mentioned in your textbook. Yeah, the next one is rainwater harvesting. This is also called as water harvesting. Now here, rainwater harvesting means you are collecting the rainwater and you are storing it properly, either in storage tanks or underground. So this water can be used in future whenever there is a shortage of water, or like for irrigation purpose also even this is used. So there is optimum use of water, and also the rainwater, sometimes what happens is it gets drained out and it finally reaches the sea. So it's of no use. So before that, before it reaches the sea, you're using this water. So then rainwater, that is collecting and storing rainwater on the surface or recharging it into the ground. Now under rainwater harvesting, the objectives and importance is also asked. Like, what are the two objectives or three objectives? They may ask, like, also the importance or the aims. So you can specify these. Recharges the groundwater, because the water that is stored, it also is, there is a channel that even recharges the underground water as well. So it recharges the underground water, it increases its level. Like I said, when due to excessive withdrawal, the groundwater gets depleted. So that after the storage, a surface storage tank fills in, you get the excess water that overflows from the surface tank, that you can recharge, that water you can recharge into the ground as well. Then next is checking surface runoff of water. When it rains heavily, generally in urban areas, there is flooding, so that water flooding water finally enters the drainage or system, and it just mixes with the sea. So there again, buildings and all have started with this rainwater harvesting, where the water is collected either on the rooftop of buildings or paved surfaces, and that water is channelized, and there is a proper filtration system, and then it enters the storage. So then that is used for other purposes, like for flush and for kitchen domestic purposes as well. So then it is environment friendly, as no pollution is caused, because no gases are released here, so obviously no carbon emissions. So then it is environment friendly, improves the groundwater quality as salinity is diluted. Like I said, when water gets recharged, if there is brackish water, then that mixes with the brackish water and the salinity also gets dilution. So it improves the quality of groundwater as more water is mixed there. Now, methods of rainwater harvesting. What are the different ways in which you can do harvesting rainwater? First is rooftop rainwater harvesting method. Second is recharging the groundwater, that is diverting the excess water there down. So you can make dug wells, percolation pits. Percolation means that water actually seeps into those pits that are made, and then it is stored there. Similarly, recharge trenches, it's almost quite similar to these. These are made of different shapes and sizes, so that the water is actually collected down there. So if any examples are asked of practices of groundwater, you can mention these as well. Now what is rooftop rainwater harvesting method? As the name says, the water, that is the rain, gets collected on the roofs of mainly of these buildings. So that's the catchment area. So these are the components that comes under rooftop rainwater harvesting. That is the elements that are required. Catchment areas. Catchment area means where it rains. So these catchment areas are, the buildings, the paved surfaces or the grounds that are there. Paved surfaces, they make them so that the water falls there and then it is diverted. and gets collected in the storage. So this is the catchment area. Now suppose if I take the example of a rooftop, like, you know, terraces there, the water flows, drops there, and then the rain falls there, and then the second it enters the coast mesh, that is where these drainage pipes are there. Like if you see on buildings or terraces, there are holes, like, through which the water actually, whenever it rains, and water enters those drain holes and it flows down and mixes with the drains. Now what they do is they make a netted mesh so that all the leaves, because there could be trees around, so if suppose leaves are there or some pebbles are there, so those things, unwanted elements are not, it doesn't enter the storage tank. So there is a mesh that is there, a wide mesh, and that obstructs all these, particles. So there is a coarse mesh or a leaf guard. After that, the water then enters into conduits actually. Now conduits, before that, see, gutters and downspouts are required only in places where the slopes, it's a sloping roof. So there what happens when water falls on the roof, the water will actually, it will just fall off, you know, from the sides, and then it won't be collected. So there is a circular pipe that is made on the edges or periphery of these slopes, so that a semicircular pipe, so the water when it falls on the roofs, it will slope down and gets collected on those pipes, and then that water is then carried through conduits. Conduits means it's like a pipe that transports the rainwater where it is collected to the storage tank. So gutters or downspouts are required only when if there is a slopy roof. Otherwise, directly from catchment area it enters, there's a coarse mesh, and then it enters the conduits here. So conduits means it's a pipe that actually takes the water from the catchment area to the storage tank. Then there is a first flush device. First flush device is installed because whenever it rains, wherever it falls, that area, you know, it could be dust particles would be there, then, bird droppings would be there, leaves would be there, the water would be very dirty and impure. So that water is not allowed to enter the filter tank. So that there is a first flush, device means there is a valve where the water from the conduit it enters, and then there is a valve there, and that, is opened, manually. So that first water, rain water is flushed out. It doesn't enter the tank. And then after that, there's a filter also in that, so that can be cleaned. And then, so maintenance is very low there. So then that water is actually flushed out. And that water, you can use it for gardening and other purposes, because that is can't be used for consumption. Then after that, the next collection of water then enters the filtration tank. It's a chamber there where you have sand, you have pebble, you have gravel, you have charcoal, different filtration chambers are there. It enters there, all the suspended dirt particles that are there, that gets, it enters here. And then the pure water then is actually passed through another pipe through the storage tank where it gets collected. Now from the storage tank, if the storage tank overflows, so there is a provision also where from the storage tank, it is actually pipes are laid and it gets connected to the underground water. So the underground water, there are bore wells or there are dug wells or percolation pits. So from there, it goes there and it gets recharged. So then from the rooftop harvesting also, you can even recharge the groundwater. So these are the methods that comes under rainwater. It is very important because sometimes they ask what are the different methods of, rainwater harvesting. So you can write rooftop rainwater harvesting, groundwater recharging by, there are different ways where we can do that, by dug wells, percolation pits and recharge trenches. All these are some examples that come under groundwater recharge. Now with this, I have completed the water resources, and next I will be starting with climate chapter.